إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فهو المهتد، ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. وبعد، الله سبحانه وتعالى in the Quran says in the last verse of سورة الكهف: فمن كان يرجو لقاء ربه فليعمل عملا صالحا ولا يشرك بعبادة ربه أحدا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informs us, the believers, about that which keeps us motivated, that which keeps us going in this life, that which keeps our deeds and our action spiritual, that which brings our heart back into our ibadah. How are you today? Today is Jum'ah. You come to the masjid. How did you enter through this door? What are you feeling? Many of us, we come with our body, but our heart is not there. Many of us complain, I pray, I have been praying for so long, but what can I do to get khushu'? My prayers is void of any spiritual meaning. How can I bring my heart back? I'm becoming like a robot. I'm coming, I'm praying, it's mechanical. How my ibadah, my worship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala became a habit? Today I want to tell you about something that's the opposite. That if we do, we can turn even our habits into worship. Something that would bring our hearts back to our everyday ibadah. Something that would keep us going through the journey of this life. Sometimes it's like a desert out there, a spiritual drought, if you will, and we have to keep going. How can I fix that? First, let me tell you this before I even start. I want you to do something. It's about doing. It's about something that we can do. Can you please smile? Smiling is a charity, and today is Jum'ah. Can we at least smile? Give me a smile. Is that so hard to ask for? You can change your state by simply changing something physical. They tell you, even if you feel depressed, looking upward to the sky. If somebody is so depressed, he's always looking down. They tell you he can't smile. You know what the doctors would tell him? Put a pencil in your mouth and bite on it because it makes you smile. And then look up to the sky. And subhanAllah, smiling is a charity. When you do that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rewards you. How easy it is. We're asking you to give charity to the masjid. I'm asking you to give charity to yourself and to me. Just smile please, inshallah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this verse, which I want to speak about, the translation is the following: whoever is hoping, whoever is looking forward to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then let him do good deeds. What motivates the believer? What makes life easy? What makes the journey of this life light? What make a desert that looks so empty, drought? I have oasis all over the place. Is the concept of having raja, having hope, wanting and seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what, do you have hope? What am I speaking about? Let me start with this, an experiment that scientists did. And yani, don't laugh, because it has to do with what I'm speaking about from a spiritual perspective. One scientist got a mouse, and he got a water, and he threw the mouse in, and he started timing him. The mouse kept swimming. 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours, 6 hours, 7 hours, he got tired. 8 hours, he stopped swimming. He gave up. He despaired. It's no use. I've been swimming for 8 hours. I'm not changing. I'm going to drown anyway. What's the good of it? So he let himself drown. And the scientist got, okay, 8 hours. They swim for 8 hours. Scientists can be cruel. And he got another mouse. And he threw him in the water. And he kept timing him. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And 7 hours, and the mouse started to give up. And that scientist went in and saved the mouse, picked him up. The next day, he threw the same mouse in the water again and stood there with the stopwatch, and he started timing him. 1 hour, 2 hour, 3 hours, 8, 10, 12, 18, 20. What's going on? And the mouse is not giving up. He's swimming. What is the difference? What? The difference is very simple. Why is this mouse swimming? He has hope. He will save me. What this mouse is doing is he's looking at the scientist and, I know he saved me yesterday. He is going to save me. He keeps swimming. His hope is not in him swimming. His hope is not in his ability. His hope is not even in his deeds. His hope is in the scientist. That is the concept of hope. The believer's hope. What are you hopeful in? What do you have hope in? الرجاء هو النظر إلى سعة رحمة الله وجوده والارتياح لمطالعة كرمه. الرجاء hope, and this is the key, is when, and it starts by another, when I look, when I refocus on the vastness of the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and therefore I feel comfortable that He's so generous. The reason I swim in this life, like this mouse, even when it's no use, I've been trying for 10 years to have khushu' and salah, it's not working. I'll swim. Why? I know me, it will never work, but I look to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I know He's Rahim. Tomorrow He's going to make me. I keep going on and on. That's the concept of al-raja. Al-raja therefore starts with one thing that we have to do. Refocus. You want to bring yani, spirit to our actions? I have to refocus my heart on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This art of refocusing. Not on myself, not on my salah, not on my deed. On Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'll give you simple examples. Al-Rabi' ibn al-Khuthayb, one of the greatest of the tabi'een. And he, when he prayed, mashallah, yani, prayers yani, half the night, all the night, he was known of his khushu' and, but how did he start his day? One thing that Rabi' ibn Khuthaym would do, we can do that. Imagine you wake up in the morning, you do the dhikr. Sometimes you do the dhikr like a parrot, right? Rabi' ibn Khuthaym, he wakes up and after he's doing the dhikr, look at his focus. He reorients his heart. How? He would say the following. As-salamu alaykum ya malaikat Allah. Uktubu. Subhanallah, alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar, la ilaha illallah. The first thing he wakes up, he says what? As-salamu alaykum, he greets the malaika. As-salamu alaykum, O angels of Allah. He reorients himself, there are angels and they're waiting to write. So he says, salamu, he gives him salam. And he says, write down. Subhanallah, alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar. Did you ever do dhikr that way? Try it. If you want your dhikr to be meaningful, imagine. Refocus, there is an angel sitting there waiting to write. And then when you say, he's speaking with them. Al-Rabi' ibn al-Khuthaym with this focus on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one day, and he was a zahid, a person that doesn't ask much. He asked his wife, I'm hungry. And I want a special type of dessert. I've been yani, longing for that. And his wife was so happy. At last, Al-Rabi' asked me for something. He never asks. He wants something. He wants to eat actually a dessert. She was so happy. She went and they said she cooked for 4 or 5 hours. You know how women sometimes, she loves her husband. She cooked for him 4 or 5 hours. And then she brought to him the dessert, the one he asked with sugar and nicely done. And she placed it between his hands. As he starts to eat, he looks to the door and here comes a poor man. And that poor man seemed to be yani, not in his right mind, if you will. Something is wrong up there. So Rabi' ibn Khuthaym looked at the poor man and then he looked to the dish. And he said, here, give it to him. And this man, it said, he's not in his right mind. He said he kept eating and slobbering over it and he made a big mess. And his son came to him, father, this man doesn't know what he's eating. You gave to him the dish that my mother spent 5 hours to make for you. He doesn't even understand the value of it. Rabi' ibn al-Khuthaym says, if he doesn't understand, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala understands. Focus. He's oriented when he's doing the action. He's doing it. Ya Allah, do you see what I'm doing? Ya Allah, he doesn't know. It is of no use. But you see it. Hope. You can accept it. And the next day, his wife came to him and she redid it. You know, he wants that dish. She made another dish of the same type. 5 hours. She brought it to him. And as he starts to eat, guess what happened? A poor person enters from the door again. And the Rabi' ibn al-Khuthaym looks at the poor person. So his wife, la, khalas, yani, enough, right? No, I have an idea. Please don't give him the dish. I have an idea. I have some dirham saved. I've saved some dollars inside. You eat the dish, I'll give him the money. Please eat the dish. He said, really? You have money? Yes. So you're going to give it to him? Yes. Said, what a good idea. Please go get the money. She was so happy. She got the money. She gave it to Rabi' ibn al-Khuthaym. He got the money. He put it on the dish. Gave both to the poor person. The ability, why? Why can he do such kind of a wonderful act? He's looking not on the poor person, on the value of this. Ya Allah, do you see what I'm doing? I have hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That inspires me to continue to do good. Similarly, there are many examples for that. I'll give you an example. There is a big difference between a person, you walk outside and it's raining, and you look and there is a bee drowning in some puddle of water. Many of us, we'll just save the bee. Many of us would leave the bee. Some of us will kill the bee, especially the young guys. A person who's focused on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this, look, to bring spirit in the act. He thinks the following way. He looks at the bee. And then he starts saving the bee. As I'm saving the bee, I say, Ya Allah, he was drowning. He was drowning. And he was about to die. I saved him. I am drowning in my sins. Please, Ya Allah, like I saved him, save me from my sins. Save me on the day of judgment. When I'm taking the bee out, I tell the bee, please be a witness for me in the hereafter. They are a witness. See, this is how I bring spirit. I know you're laughing and saying, what is he doing? What? This is how I bring my heart in the concept of raja' that Allah can accept. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so merciful. What brings raja' or hope in my heart is looking at Allah as a shakur. Allah is very thankful. Ismillah subhanahu wa ta'ala al-shakur. What does al-shakur means? Thank. Shakur means to thank. Yashkur to thank. Well, I understand how I thank another person, but Allah is thankful. What does that mean? Al-shakur fi al-lugha ya'ni ziyada. Al-shakur means the one that increases. Meaning what linguistically? You do something very small, he multiplies it tremendously, immensely. He rewards so much for something that's very small. That's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a shakur. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is indeed, I'll give you yani a story related to that, and I think it's important. The hadith that we all know, the hadith, the sahih hadith, and it's so important, and please focus on it. This woman that was doing something that's wrong. That woman that was a prostitute, actually, as according to the hadith. That's terrible. That's horrible. But we know from the hadith, if you see her, I won't even look at her. Some people won't let her in the masjid, right? But subhanAllah, she saw a dog and the dog was thirsty. What did she do? As you know from the hadith, she went into the well, brought some water, gave it to the dog. فَشَكَرَ اللَّهُ لَهَا فَغَفَرَ لَهَا. So Allah was thankful, grateful for her deed. And he forgave her all her sins. Allah subhanahu, what? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can forgive with such an act? But wait a minute. Why? Did you ever feed a hungry dog or cat? What made her act so special? Why? I'll tell you something. Because she understands the concept of raja'. Why? Her sins, her mistakes were not a reason for her to stop having hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. See, many of us have a problem. We have hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because we pray. We have hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because I made hajj. I have hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because I give charity. I have hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when I'm doing good. Scholars said hope is of two types. And please focus on this. This is tremendously important. There is hope that Allah would accept my deed. That I'm fasting, Ya Allah, please accept. Alhamdulillah. But there is a second type of hope. That I'm hopeful, I have hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He will forgive my sins. Real hope is not when you're good. Real hope is not when you're obedient. Real hope in Allah is when I slip, when I mess up, when I fall on my face and I say, you know what? Allah can still accept. That's what she did. Whatever she was doing in her life, whatever miserable things, tremendous crime she was doing, did not stop her from giving a charity to that dog, giving water to a dog. She said in her heart, yes, I'm doing those horrible things, yet yes, I believe Allah can still accept from me. Yes, Allah will still accept that deed. Can you imagine? You know how that, yani that's like? Unfortunately, we don't think that way. Because we think, if a thief comes to your house, and he steals everything, he goes to your house, takes everything inside. On the way out, he cleans your car, you know, wipes your car nicely. What are you going to think? Are you joking? Is this a joke? You're cleaning my car and stealing my house. It's not acceptable. Go away. Like, it's not thinkable, right? What good are you doing? Why are you cleaning my car? You just stole my house. So, actually, I'll mock him for that. With Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's the opposite. إِنَّ الْحَسَنَاتِ يُذْهِبْنَ السَّيِّئَاتِ. Doing a good deed omits an evil deed. Imagine if somebody did that to you and you went and you said, MashaAllah, you just wiped my car. You know I forgive you. Take everything you took from my house. It's for you. You're forgiven. We can't imagine this, can you? And unfortunately, we assume that Allah is the same way. Allah is al-Shakur. Allah is al-Ghafur. Allah is looking for anything that you would do, so He would reward you with anything. There is a big difference. That's how I bring, again, life to what I'm doing. There is a story about a man by the name of Abu Nasr al-Sayyad. and he was a poor man, and he doesn't have much, and he was a fisherman. And one day he was sitting, there is nothing to do, and my kids have no food at home, right? And he's sitting miserable. So a sheikh came to him and told him, what's that? Take your net, go to the sea, say Bismillah, have hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will provide for you. And he said, and yes, and he went and he took his net and he said, Bismillah, tawakkaltu ala Allah, and he threw the net and he pulls it and comes one fish. But the man was so happy, at last something, and he rushed to the marketplace. My kids are hungry, we have nothing at home. And I want you to imagine his state. And he sells the fish and he gets bread and some sweets. And he's rushing home, and I imagine his state thinking about what my kids and the happiness on their face when I show them this. On the way, he sees a woman sitting there. The woman didn't speak, and the child on her lap. And he said the woman, just the look on her face, and the child, his eyes were locked on the food. And he said, I understood what's going on. She's hungry too. But the woman didn't ask anything. She didn't say anything. But he saw in her kid, the eyes locked on the food. So what did he say? Look at the concept again of hope here. He said, he looked to the food and looked to the kid. And he said, here, take all of it. Ya Allah, you see me. You see me now. Look at what I'm doing. Here, take the food. That will please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ya Allah, I want your pleasure. Take the food. And he felt so good as he's walking back towards his house. What happens? What did I do? Did I give her everything? Shouldn't I have given her half and kept half? Now what will I do? My family, my kids. And he started to kind of regret. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Shakur, the most grateful. He would reward tremendously with small deeds. And he finds a man in the marketplace. Where is Abu Nasr al-Sayyad? Where is Abu Nasr al-Sayyad? And they tell him, here he is. And he comes to him. You are Abu Nasr al-Sayyad? And he says, yes. He said, I was a colleague of your father. We used to do business together long time ago. And he gave me money. And I put it in my business. And it multiplied. And I've been looking for you to give you your share. Here, 30,000 dirham for you. That's your share. So Abu Nasr said, Subhanallah, look, a small deed that I did. And look what Allah gave me. The story doesn't end there. He said, I changed and I became very generous. And Alhamdulillah, we became rich. And I used to give charity, 100 dirham, 10 dirham, 5 dirham, generous. Till one night, I was sleeping and I saw a dream. And in that dream, I saw the judgment day. And on that day, I saw myself standing, and the caller asked for me to stand between the hands of Allah. And I saw the balance, you know, al-mizan, on the day of judgment. And he said, I heard angels saying, where is his bad deeds? And my bad deeds are brought. And I look at them and they're like mountains. I did so many terrible things I didn't know. And he said, it was so heavy. And then an angel said, where is his good deeds? And he said, I saw my good deeds coming, and they would be placed on the other balance, other side of the balance. But they're so light. My sadaqah would fall like feather, like cotton. It's not doing any. Why? Sometimes we give charity, with it is self-adoration. We do something, and with it, sometimes the actions of our heart are not present in our ibadah. I pray, but my heart is not there. It makes it so light, it's not worth anything. And he said, the scale is not moving, and I was terrified. And then the angel said, does he have anything other than that left? And they said, no, that's it. He said, I was terrified. What will happen to me? What will Allah do to me? And he said, an angel called, wait, he still have three things. What was it? He said, I saw that small piece of bread that I gave to the woman coming down on my scale in a physical form. And it moved my scale down. And then all of a sudden, an angel said, he still has another thing. The smile of the woman, the smile of the kid, when I gave them this charity, came in a physical form. It fell on the scale and it started to balance and they were equal. And then the angel said, he still has one more thing. What was it? The drop of tear coming from the woman's eye as I gave her the food, because she was so happy, came like an ocean, fell into my scale of good deeds, overwhelmed everything, and I was saved. What's the moral of the story? One deed, it can save me. I go through this life with that. I'm hoping that this deed would be the deed that will save me. The sheikh asked you to give charity, right? There is a box outside. One of us would go, Alhamdulillah, Jazakumullah khair, ya sheikh, here is my charity, he puts it in the box. But the heart is not engaged, versus someone else that will remember this hadith. And he goes to this charity box saying, yes, And as I take my $10 even, $1, I'm putting it in the charity box. I'm imagining. My heart, my focus is on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I imagine the day of judgment. And as I put this $1 in the charity box, I imagine this $1 coming in the day of judgment. How will it look in my balance of good deed? And I have hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that deed, may that deed be the deed that will save me on that day. An action done that way, an action done with a heart present that way, with this kind of raja, has a spiritual meaning. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can multiply. Look, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, looking on Allah's rahmah, enable us to do deeds and have hope in Him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so merciful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives even on intentions. Do you know what that means? إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّةِ A human has nothing except what he was striving for. Do you know the meaning? There is a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And you know the hadith, it's sahih. And it's narrated in Bukhari and Muslim. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the angel, when my righteous servant, when my intends to do something good, write it down. Write it as a hasana. And if he does it, multiply it by 10. You know what that means? If I just intend something, I get a hasana. Yet many of us, we're afraid to intend big. We're afraid to dream big. We always make my intention small. Why? Because I'm afraid I won't be able to do it. I won't be able to accomplish it. Remember the verse, وَأَلَّيْسَ لِلْإِنسَانِ إِلَّا مَسَاعَ A human being has nothing except what he strived for. What? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to ask you, what did you achieve? No. Can you imagine the generosity? What were you striving for? Like, my car is broken outside. I get a mechanic. He stays there. 5 hours fixing the car, he breaks it down. What are you going to do to him? Are you going to give him his... I'm going to scream at him. You broke my car after 5 hours. Allah doesn't treat us this way. Imagine if I say, MashaAllah, you intended to fix my car. You had good intention. You were striving to fix the car. Here is your money, although it doesn't work. Allah rewards us that way. And subhanAllah, the opposite. In the other hadith, the angels would call to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Rabb, in hadha abdak, hamma bi sayyi'ah. Oh Allah, this is one of your servants intending to do something bad. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would say, hold, don't write it down yet. If he does it, write it as one. And if he ends up leaving it, write it as a hasana. Write it as a good deed. He left it for me. Do you know what the meaning of this hadith is? Every time you have a bad thought, if I say, Ya Allah, no, I'm leaving it for your sake, it becomes a hasana. Every time shaitan whispers to me to do something bad, and I say, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. Can you imagine if one of you went to his wife and told her, you know what, today I was at work and there was this woman over there. She's so pretty, she's so nice. I wanted to invite her out for a date. And as I was doing that, I was approaching her, I remembered you. So I decided to stop. What will your wife do? Never do this. That will be the end, right? You intended to do what? That's it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, on the other hand, He is grateful. He would give. And the one thing I want us to focus on, this concept of raja, even when I slip, even when I do something wrong. Yani Yahya ibn Mu'adh al-Razi, he said it so beautifully. He said, إلهي رجاء إن رجاء لك مع الذنوب أن تغفرها يكاد يغلب رجاء لك مع الطاعة أن تقبلها. Oh dear God, oh يا إلهي, my hope that you would forgive my sins outweighs my hope that you would accept my good deeds. Why? He said, لأني أجدني في الذنب أعتمد على مغفرتك وكيف لا تغفر وأنت بالجود معروف. Because I find that when I slip, I'm totally dependent on your forgiveness, your generosity. How can't you forgive while forgiveness and generosity is your attribute? While in good deeds, I'm depending on my own sincerity. And how can I make it sincere while with defects I'm known? This is the kind of hope we need. The hope when we slip that keeps us going. Shaitan, look, one of the most dangerous things, I warn you from. Please, this is so important, especially for our young generation here. Shaitan sometimes, his name is Iblis, Ablasa. You know what Ablasa means in Arabic? Ablas means who lost hope. One of his biggest things to do is to make you lose hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of us would slip and shaitan would come to you and he would tell you what? Are you going to go to the masjid now? After what you did, you're a hypocrite. How can you go there? They'll never accept you. That is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns about in the Quran. بلى من كسب سيئة وأحاطت به خطيئته فأولئك أصحاب النار. No, but nay, the one that gains a wrong, does something wrong, does a سيئة, he gains it. But that was not the problem. وأحاطت به خطيئته. And his sin, his slip, surrounded him. Surrounded him. This is the one that will end up in hellfire. What does it mean, surround him? I do something wrong and I despair. I lose hope. خلاص, Allah can forgive me. There is no door left for me to go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from. That is the one that will end in hellfire. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. Always look. Sins, shortcomings, slips are my description. Forgiveness, generosity, pardoning is his attribute and his description. His attribute and his acts will always outweigh my act. We always seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're always hopeful in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As a matter of fact, one of the biggest things you can do in your life, if you are slipping, if it is negative, if you're doing something wrong, within it, you tell Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Allah, I still have hope in you. I still have hope in you. That can be the biggest deed in my life that I do. قولوا قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أفضل المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه الطيبين الطاهرين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. وبعد, one of the things that hope would lead to, one other ibadah that's closely related to it, what is your thought about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Many of us, and this is a ibadah that we seldom do, the problem is we don't have good thoughts about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some of us, if I ask you, what are you thinking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will he accept? Are you going to be in Jannah? Many of us will. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the hadith, hadith Qudsi, أنا عند ظن عبدي بي. I am what my servant thinks about me. Do you understand this concept, what it means? He left it to you. I am what you think of me. What does that, if I think, yes, Allah is so generous. Yes, Allah will save me. Yes, Allah is forgiving. So be it. So be it. And if I think, no, 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 Allah is never going to forgive me. I can't change. I will never change. So be it. I always have to have good thoughts of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. حسن الظن بالله. I'll give you two narrations happening in the hereafter, telling you how that having رجاء in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and looking at his vastness and what he does can save a person. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam narrated by Anas ibn Malik that one time he smiled. And Umar ibn al-Khattab sitting there and look at the companions, he immediately noticed the Prophet smiling. Oh Prophet of Allah, what made you smile? There's meaning here. They're very watchful of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. What made you smile? What makes me smile? That I won $1 million. That my kids took. My kid is now a PhD in engineering. What makes me smile? What makes the Prophet smile? So he sallallahu alayhi wasallam told Umar ibn al-Khattab, and Anas narrates this. I saw a situation in the hereafter. Two people among my ummah, sitting on their knees in front of each other. One of them is telling Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, خذ مظلمتي من أخي. Take from my brother what he wronged me with. He did something wrong to me in the life of this world. Take it back. I want it. I want his hasanat. And the other guy saying, Ya Allah, I have no hasanat left. I have nothing left. I have nothing to give him anymore. So that other guy says to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, let him take from my sins. Let him take from my sins. And if he does that, the guy will drown. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon narrating this, by the way, tears comes out from his eyes. Why? Shafaqa, rahmah on his ummah. And he said, this is a great day, a grave day, where people will be in desperate need for some hasana. Desperate. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and look at here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's rahmah and generosity. They're fighting. And he sees what's going on. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the person demanding, he tells him, irfa' ra'asak. Raise your head. And he raises his head. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala removes the veil. And that person sees Jannah, sees paradise. And he sees palaces and says, Ya Allah, what are those for? What kind of, for which prophet is that? For which shaheed is that? For which siddiq is that? That's immense, that's unimaginable. He sees Jannah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is for the one that owns the price for it. And the man says, who can ever own the price for this? It's priceless. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells him, you own it. I, he said, yes. بِعَفْوِكَ عَنْ أَخِيكَ. If you would forgive your brother. عَفَوْتُ يَا رَبْ. I forgave him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, look at this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says what? خُذْ بِيَدِ أَخِيكَ وَادْخُلَ الْجَنَّةِ. Take his hand and go together in Jannah, both of you. When you know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that way, even when I slip, even when I wrong others, you know when you wrong others and you say, I can't fix it. I don't know what to do. I did something wrong that I can't fix. I destroyed my relation with my kid. He's never going to forgive me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allahul Wali. Allahul Wali. Al-Wali, Al-Habib, Al-Ladhi Yansurak, Al-Qarib, Al-Ladhi Yara'ak. The one that's near, that brings victory to you. The one that is beloved, that will always make you victorious. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Wali, fi dunya wa fi al-akhirah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if I'm with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if I see Him, I still have hope. That's called tahammul al-tabi'at. And I finish with this other hadith, other narration of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the day of judgment, telling us the immense bounty and reward of having this ibadah of the heart, of being hopeful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hadith on the day of judgment, a servant, and he is in front of the scales, and the angel weighs everything, and his deeds are so negative, everything is bad, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, take him to hellfire. Khalas, nothing is left. And as the angels take him to hellfire, this man starts looking behind. Still looking behind him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and he knows, bring him back. Why were you looking behind? He said, Ya Allah, I was still hopeful that you are going to save me from hellfire. Allah tells the angels, take him to paradise. He has hope in me. Even in that situation, he did not despair from the mercy of Allah. I would leave you with something practical to do. Here is something I have, the suwak. Right? You know what that is? A suwak that you clean your teeth with. Aisha radiallahu anha, Umm al-Mu'mineen, she said, a suwak, this thing, which is a dollar. Matharatun lil-fam, you clean your mouth with. Wa mardatun lil-rabb, and gains you Allah's happiness and satisfaction. What? You understand? To make someone happy with me, what do I have to do? How much do I have to spend to make Allah happy with me? All what I have to do is what? Look at Allah and His rahmah. I take this and use it. Subhanallah. There is a big difference between somebody who's using it and another person who takes the suwak and say, Ya Allah, you made your happiness. You made your happiness in something that I can buy with $1. And of course I'm using it. And as I'm using it, I'm thinking about Allah is happy with me now. That brings life, if you will, in every single deed I do. The ibadah I spoke about today, just to finish, is the ibadah of hope. Having hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not losing hope. Not despairing from Allah's rahmah, even when things are dark. Always searching for the dog like that woman. Where if your life, if you slip and everything is negative, it is Allah that sent this dog. Remember the prostitute? And Allah sent a dog. There is something in your life that you can do. إِنَّ الْحَسَنَاتِ يُذْهِبْنَ السَّيِّئَاتِ. Never despair, even when we slip. Even when we slip, always focus on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before doing a deed, before we pray. Is it going to be the prayers that Allah will accept? It can be. أَنَا عِنْدَ ظَنَّ عَبْدِي بِي. If that's what you're thinking, Ya Allah, it is now when we pray now. Now it's going to be the one time that you're going to accept and release me from hellfire. So be it. When I fast, same thing. I'll finish with this, and I said it in Ramadan. Something I personally do to bring... You fast Mondays, right? You fast Thursdays, right? When I fast Mondays and Thursdays sometimes, I would go to Walmart. Why? Because I remember the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Musnad Ahmad. Even the fish in the sea asks for forgiveness for those who are fasting till they break their fast. If I'm fasting, how many fish are in the sea? Can you imagine? All the creation is asking Allah to forgive. So if I fast on Monday, I go to Walmart and I see a fish tank. And guess what do I do? Salamu alaykum, jazakum Allah khair. Don't you want your heart back? I mean, you're laughing. This is what we have to do. Unfortunately, we don't imagine anymore. We lost the ability to imagine in this materialistic culture. We don't have any thoughts about Allah. We don't see how Allah is looking at me when I do something.
That's why we're so dry. The more I know of Allah, the more I'm hopeful in Him, the more I bring my focus in every small deed, the more my deeds are multiplied, the more easier the life of this world is. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه اللهم حبب إلينا الإيمان وزينه في قلوبنا وكره إلينا الكفر والفسوق والعصيان واجعلنا من الراشدين اللهم رد أمة محمد إلى لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله وصلى الله على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم وأقم الصلاة.
الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله